Hello, folks. It's Billy here from the SWN Podcast. Before our episode coming up with Jan the Slavic One, and a little, hopefully a little bit of Stan, I'd just let you know that it looks a little bit different because I use my phone for this particular recording. Timings were just all over the place with just trying to organize our chat with Jan. So I had to record on my phone in my kitchen. So I didn't know how to get the side-by-side thing on my phone through the Zoom app. So that's why it's a bit stranger to watch. If you're listening to this, to the audio, hopefully it hasn't affected the audio too much. But enjoy. This is the penultimate episode for season 5 of the SWN podcast. We've got the Day of Birth Bonanza coming up on July 2nd. I hope you're prepared for that episode. It is a tense episode for when it is all to play for and everybody wants to win the Day of Birth Bonanza Championship. So enjoy this chat with Jan, and like I say, hopefully we might sneak in a little bit of Stan in there and have a good time. So thank you. Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I'm in a new location. I am in my kitchen, which is very apropos because that's where I did my first episode ever, was in this very kitchen. And I'm now doing the penultimate episode of the season of season 5 in my kitchen again. I am joined on this edition. It was supposed to be Jan, the Slavic One, and Stan, but Stan has not appeared. There was a little bit said connecting and then disappeared, but we've got Jan of many names, but we'll go for just Jan for this. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. I don't know what's happening with Stan. That's all the time. Like, people think we are two separate people. Oh, sorry. People think we are the same person, but we are actually two separate people and people don't realize it. And
I know,
now
it was so difficult to get Stan on board initially. I don't know what the connection's like in Eastern Europe, but
don't even write me. He needs to send me like a pigeon messages, you know, so I can get in contact with him. It's horrible. Imagine we have like a family meeting and the only way you can get him in contact with is literally sending a pigeon. Unbelievable.
I mean, I don't know how Ravy David gets a hold of him for community pro wrestling, but that's another mystery for another day, possibly. But this is about you then. So advertise as Jan and Stan, but we're going to speak to Jan, which I think, you know, is probably, as you kind of alluded to, it's probably going to be more of a chattier podcast with yourself as it would be with Stan if there's going to be a language barrier.
Yeah, definitely. Anyway. Definitely. You're right about that. Stan can't even say a sentence, so it's better with me anyway.
Excellent. So we'll start with the most boring podcast question that we can ever imagine on a wrestling podcast, but it's a nice icebreaker. What got you into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that you watched it or saw pro wrestling for the first time and thought, yes, this is the best thing ever?
Oh, man. See, for me, it's like, it was like when I was a kid, obviously, right? That's how everyone starts as a kid. There's no way you can watch professional wrestling in Czech Republic because you don't have WWE Network. They don't play on tele. You need to find your own way to it, you know? And I just remember, it's like, there's these three stories, right? So for the very, very first time, it was The Rock. Like, because he's a famous Hollywood star, you know? He was just coming out of the King Scorpion movie, right?
And oh, wow. Okay.
I remember, yeah, I mean, me and my brother, we were like, oh, see this guy, he's actual like fire, like a wrestler. I was like, oh, really? And then he showed me some matches of his on SmackDown, you know? And I didn't even know it was a SmackDown at that time. And we watched the Armageddon 2000, right?
Oh, nice, yeah.
Was it the Hell in a Cell, right? The six-man Hell in a Cell when Rikishi fell off the top of the roof? Is that one?
Yeah, that's the one, yeah.
Yeah, so we watched that one and we were like, oh, mesmerized. And then it just vanished for a long time, right? Then my best friend came to me. Shout out to my best friend, Pepa Ovčečík. And he showed me a video of Rey Mysterio. And again, I was blown away. It was like, oh my God, this guy is brilliant. It was just, you know, a montage of Rey Mysterio doing 619s, you know, doing like the head scissors and just the Lucha Libre stuff. Just amazing. And then again, it just vanished for a short while until I celebrate my 12th birthday. And that's when I invited my friends over and I had PlayStation 2, right? So we always like doing like the gaming parties, so we were like playing games together, you know, have a laugh, you know, and my friend brought a WWE game, and it was a SmackDown versus Raw 2007, and that's where it started. That's where everything started. D-Generation X, Batista, John Cena, Edge, all these amazing wrestlers. I was just mesmerized. Then we watched them actually do stuff on YouTube. Me and my best friend, we became best, biggest DX fans you can imagine. We were running out of school, you know, shout everyone, suck it! Hey! We didn't even know what that means. We didn't speak English at that time, so we didn't know what it means, you know? Like, I got two words for ya! start crotching, you know, and everything. We didn't even know what it means. They did it, and it looked cool, so we gotta do it as well.
That's amazing, because that was the second the second proper big run of DX as well. Because I remember I went to my first ever WWE show the year before in 2006. So getting to see DX in their second run, you know, people the oldie Attitude Era is the best thing ever. Like, didn't like it, but it was the best thing. It was the best thing.
I mean, come on, like, they make a fun of Vince McMahon who likes cocks, you know, and just like, come on, this is just brilliant. We were stupid wee boys, you know, and this was our humor, you know, this was like exactly what we were laughing at, you know, like making up people's wieners, you know, and stuff like that. It was amazing. I hated John Cena, though.
All right, okay.
Because, okay, I'm a little sloth boy at this time, right? And I was a metalhead as well. And what was John Cena at that time? You know, he was a rapper. Yeah. So, like, in Czech Republic, it was like, you're either a rapper or a metalhead. And if you're a metalhead, you don't like rappers? It's stupid. It's very stupid. But how it used to go back when I was growing up. But, yeah, and that's when I became a fan. I didn't decide to be a wrestler yet. So I was watching stuff on YouTube. Mind you, this is not 2006. This is like 2010, 2011. But because everything is a little bit behind in Czech Republic, you know what I mean? So these videos getting up to me just now, like from Ruthless Aggression, that's when I see Ruthless Aggression, I'm getting nostalgia, even though I start watching wrestling in 2011, 2012, like regularly. Like, and I'm talking like every Raw, every SmackDown, every main event, every superstar, every... Do you remember when they did the kids show every Saturday morning?
Saturday morning slam, something like that, wasn't it?
I even watched that, you know. I was so crazy into it. I fell in love with wrestling, and I decided to be a wrestler when I started watching Daniel Bryan. Daniel Bryan is like my favorite wrestler of all time, and it's him because I watched his journey from independent wrestling, you know, and he's like the gateway to independent wrestling to me. So then I found out like stuff like ROH exist, stuff like New Japan exist, stuff like a AAA exist, you know, like these companies outside of WWE. And I was just mesmerized, you know? So at that time, I decided I'm going to be a wrestler. I was like 15 or something. And I already told my parents, Mom, after I graduate police academy, I'm going aboard and I'm going to be a professional wrestler. And at this time, I didn't know where I'm going to go. Right? I'm going to be a wrestler. I don't know how, but I'm just going to be a wrestler, right? Then when I was 18-ish, do you remember, I'm 25 now, so you can like compare the timelines. So when I was 18, I started watching What Culture, right? It was like, that was my gateway to wrestling in Czech Republic. I already speak English at that time, so I understand every video they released. So I knew what they were talking about, right? Mm-hmm. And they start doing their own wrestling show called WCPW.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was an amazing show. Just amazing show. And that's when I was introduced to Scottish professional wrestling, like British, but mainly Scottish, because my favorite wrestlers from that show were Joe Henry and BT Gunn. I fell in love with those wrestlers, you know. Through them, I learned about ICW. And I started watching ICW like clips online, and I just became massive fan of Wolfgang and Lionheart. So I mentioned four names, and three of those four names were my coaches.
So you definitely, Scotland, obviously, that was, as soon as you started seeing What Culture, that was kind of your spiritual home from that point, was you had to be in Scotland if you're going to learn to be a wrestler.
Exactly. I remember, I got this memory. I was behind my computer right in Czech Republic, and I meant to study for my, how you call it over here?
GCSEs.
Yeah. It's a little bit different in Czech Republic. Like we get different education system, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like for us, it's like very hardcore. Anyway, that doesn't matter. I meant to learn for that, but instead I was legit looking up for schools, right? And I was like, what is this GPWA? What is this Glasgow Professing Asylum? And I googled it. I was like, what? I can be trained by BT Gunn? I can be trained by Wolfgang? I can be trained by Lionheart? Sign me in. I already found my school. And that's what happened. I moved to Scotland. I was homeless. That happened. What else could happen? I barely could speak English. I could speak English, but not like I'm talking right now, right? Mm-hmm. Especially not Scottish. And I ended up on the streets for a short while, for a week. Didn't have a job, didn't have any qualification for anything. You know, I was so blind. You know what I mean? I just went to it. I'm going to be a wrestler no matter what. So I just literally jumped on the plane and went straight to Glasgow. And I was like, what's going to happen is going to happen. Mm-hmm. Luckily for me, there was a friend of mine who took me in, and his name was Brian, and he was like my English teacher. He was teaching me in Glasgow English, right, before I was homeless. Mm-hmm. And he found out I was homeless, so he took me in, and I was living with him for a few months, and then when I had enough money for my own flat, I got my own flat, and my fiance from Czech Republic moved in as well. This is I'm talking January 2019. Yeah.
Right. Okay.
And sadly, Brian passed away. So he didn't saw me wrestling, unfortunately. Oh.
So there's a lot to unpack in that story. I'll try and pick a couple of bits that stuck in my mind as you're going through that. So first off, I think I would be silly if I didn't go back to you taking your police exams to go to the police. So did you pass? Were you a police officer for a little bit in the Czech Republic?
Oh my God, I passed on the second try. See, I'm going to explain it, right? In Czech Republic, when you got elementary school, or primary school, sorry, England, Britain, I know, I'm not American. So you got primary school, and we got like a two levels of primary school. We got first level and second level, right? Second level of our primary school is like your high school, right?
Okay.
And our high school is like a college to you. It's the same level, right? If it makes sense. And you spend 4 years in a high school, in a Czech high school. So you spend all those 4 years preparing for the final test, which is like similar to the, you would say, the GCSE,
mm-hmm.
right?
Okay.
It's similar to it, but it's more hardcore in a way that you got 3 chances and you got many subjects. If you don't pass any of those subjects, you need to do it again, right? And you got only 3 chances. If you don't pass them 3 times, you need to repeat all those 4 years again.
Wow.
Yeah.
Jeez. I think if that was implemented in here, I think most people I know would still be in school.
I mean, no, I'm not going to say it. I'm not going to say it. No, nothing. Don't mind me. It's like many subjects. What I had, because I was in a police academy, right? That's like when you leave primary school, you need to decide, and you're 15 at that time, you need to decide what you're gonna do for the rest of your life, mm-hmm. right? So you're gonna apply to be a bricklayer, or you're gonna apply to be a lawyer, or you're gonna apply to be, you know, like you have to, and it's like hard to get into it, into this, those schools, because you're doing like a induction test, and they don't have to like bring you in. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I was doing police academy. Guess why? Because of wrestling, because they were doing self-defense. Because there are no schools in Czech Republic. See, there are no schools in Czech Republic, and closest thing to wrestling is MMA, right? Okay. At least in my mind. So I applied for school that teaches MMA and self-defense and guns and whatever. So that was, see, the wrestling, the goal of being a wrestler, that was always back in my mind. Always, every time, everything I did was hopefully one day I could make it. If it makes sense.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I know a lot of people, like, if they didn't do wrestling, if it was before like GPWA and the more influx of more readily available schools, a lot more people would do a sport or a martial art, because that would be your fix to try and at least have a basis there. But for yourself, like I said, the closest is go to police academy and doing.
Yeah.
I mean, self defense, you find, is probably one of the more important things to know in wrestling. If you're, depending where you're going, if you're not in a new environment, if you don't know who you're with, at least you know, well, if something does happen, I'm there, I'm sorted, I can do it. And just to get my own joke out of the way, when you said guns, it's like, well, at least you know how to do some shoot wrestling.
And we'll there you go.
There you go. So you come over to, you see GPW, you see WCPW, which I'm finding a lot more, like, I'm 32, and by the time this episode comes out, I'll still be 32, but like by just like by 4 days. So I'll be just 32. So for me, I got into wrestling, and a lot of people my age got into wrestling because of Channel 4, and it had a couple of 2000 pay-per-views. It had Heat, Heat on, stuff like that. And then I'm finding people that are like the generation below me, I suppose, like 20s, mid-20s. Mm-hmm. It's WCPW that seems to be or the video games seems to be the jumping off point because of the readily available access. Because when I started watching, there was dial up, and there was you go to WWF.com and wait 20 minutes for the webpage to load up if you want to find out what's happened the night before on Raw. Because if you didn't and you had Sky Sports, you had to wait till Thursday to watch Raw.
Oh.
So it was, yeah, or you had a friend. You had a friend who had Box who paid for Box Office, and that's how I watched it. I waited for him to tape it. He watched it on the Monday, gave me the tape on the Tuesday morning. I'd watch it Tuesday, Wednesday, give it back to him on Thursday. It was a delicate ecosystem.
Yeah.
When it came to wrestling.
I don't know if I can mention this, but I was watching wrestling illegally in Czech Republic because that's the only way I could watch it.
We all did.
There you go. So it's all right then.
I mean, that's essentially what tape trading was. I mean, it was a cool thing, and we glamorize it, but essentially it was like pirating, because we taped it, and I was too young for tape trading, but I'm too old for streaming. I'm like in that middle ground. So the tape trading essentially was illegal, we just go, the good old days when you could do that. So WCPW, we're out there. Joe Hendry, perfect. BT Gunn. I didn't watch WCPW. I don't know why. I think some of the guys, it got a weird rap of some people were like, oh, it's just YouTubers putting on a show.
Yeah.
And then the other side of the coin was you get introduced to all these new faces and new wrestlers, and you get to see your Will Ospreys, you get to see your Cody Rhodes, he was there, you get to see all these, you get Jim Ross on commentary, you get all that kind of slice of nostalgia at the same time. I think it's because I'm always like, I have very limited time anyway, and I need to pick and choose what I could watch, and WCPW just never did it for me. But
see do you know how Cody Rhodes is very popular right now, right? He's like a number one baby face in the world, basically. Anyway, I've been a fan of his, not because of his WWE stuff, but after he left WWE and he became Cody Rhodes, and it was through WCPW because he was internet champion and he was putting these amazing matches, you know? And that's when I was a big fan of his theme song, Kingdom, which is now one of the most popular theme songs ever, you know? So, you know, WCPW contributed a lot to the wrestling community. It's sad they had to go away.
And they did try to do like big things, because you had other places like your Five Star Wrestling and you had your WOS Wrestling, and they just didn't seem to be as, they seemed to be, they were trying to try and do something, but didn't have the absolute passion for it to make it right. Whereas the guys at WCPW seemed to do that. They kind of had a bit more of investment, a bit more of right, we're bringing in these big names, but we're also bringing in these British guys. We're also doing it as well. So as much as folk did like at the time, it's brought a generation of wrestlers into business. I mean, for example, like this past week, I don't know if you saw Rob Florence put up, it was 10 years since Kelvin Brawl. And that was a massive event at Kelvin Hall. And that event introduced a lot of now wrestlers to wrestling, because like Grant McIver was at that show, and mm-hmm. you had a lot of people on that show, like Lionheart and Noam Dar, and you had Grado and Red Lightning, and you had all these big names in Scottish wrestling, and this is the chance for people to go, oh, there is a scene here. We can go see, oh, ICW's on. Cool, I'll go to that next weekend and all that. So honestly, this ramble is going to end up with me just going, I don't care how people get into wrestling, just get into it.
Yeah. But I mean, see, another thing like that contributed me into loving British wrestling and Scottish wrestling especially was also like the if you remember back, I think it was 2017, the first ever United Kingdom the tournament.
The NXT one.
Before it was NXT. That's when I saw Wolfgang for the first time. Right, and I was just amazed what this guy can do. He's this guy is over 2 meters. Oh yeah, I'm a European. I'm using meters. Sorry, 2 meters above 100 kilos. You know, and he's doing moonsaults. He's doing not moonsault. I'm horrible with names. But you know, I mean, like the stuff he does, it's absolutely amazing. I was like, that's why I was absolutely amazed with British wrestling, Scottish especially. And I think it's because I was watching, because why? Because WCPW. Because there were some guys from WCPW that were on that tournament, right? And I just fell in love with British wrestling. And for me, it was always Scotland. Not any other, not England, not Wales. Scotland is... Glasgow should get more reputation of being like one of the most, like the capital of British wrestling. Because look how many wrestling companies we have just in Glasgow, right? How many shows, wrestling shows we have just in Glasgow. ICW was huge, you know? Like they had a show in Hydro. That was before All In. You know what I mean? it's like, I know what they say about New York, right? If you make it in New York, you can make it anywhere. I'm saying in British wrestling, if you can make it to Glasgow, you can make it anywhere as well.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, you're talking about that. There's so many shows on. I mean, I think August 5th, there's 3 shows on the same day.
Yeah.
And they're within like 10 miles of each other. Yes. Which that's possibly the other side of the coin. There's too much wrestling in that kind of respect, where you kind of got to choose a show area. But
if it gets jobs to the people, you know, and entertainment to the fans, does it really matter? You know what I mean? I know I know there are some wrestlers who are struggling with it because I don't want to call names because this is personal, but let's say like one wrestler had to wrestle both shows, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a very issue for him. We were just doing I'm not gonna call names. We were doing one show in Kirkintilloch, right? And we had this one wrestler who had to travel from one show to another, and it was like he had to start in that show, like her first match. Mm-hmm. And then go all the way back to be in the main event of the show in Kirkintilloch. That's just insane. And it's good because, I mean, come on, wrestlers getting jobs and people are getting entertainment. Isn't that great?
Absolutely. Yeah. That's it. I mean, if as long as it doesn't like kill a town, if you're going to, and like, God, I'm starting to sound like I know what I'm talking about. But if those 3 shows are on, and 2 shows have, I don't know, 150 people, that's really good. But if the 3rd show has 20 people, then what was the point of that show being on? You know, so it's a weird thing. But like I said, I'm not going to any of them, so I don't know what I'm talking about. Anyway, so and this isn't a political thing. Let's get back to Jan. So GPWA, you saw GPWA, and that was it. You saw people that you knew. You saw your Wolfgang, you saw your what have you, and that was it. You were going there. It sounds crazy though. You went there with pretty much your background was police self defense. you went there with no room, no board.
Yeah,
a very basic grasp of English.
Yeah,
and then you turned up and just went, yeah, I'm going to be a wrestler. So
yeah.
How, so it was just pretty much as soon as you took that first induction class, it was just all or nothing? Was it just you had to make it, or what was your kind of thoughts going into that first induction?
Oh, no, I knew I'm going to make it. Yeah. I know it sounds very, 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 very stupid, like very egoistic, but I was like, I had no choice. I had to make it, yeah. You know? And it's not like, it sounds like I was struggling or anything. No, I enjoyed every second. I got this memory when it was very, very first class. And by the way, just want to say, like, when we started, it was like 25 people in that class, right? And it ended up only three people who are still active to this day. And it's me, it's Nicole Jasmine, and it's Archie Williams. We started all together, right? And now, I mean, I don't know, have you been in Iron Gilders last Saturday?
No, I've seen pictures. That's pretty much my experience of Iron Girders.
Archie Williams made his debut over there. And how over he was. I'm so proud of my boy, you know? He got the massive pop. And that was in Parkhead. He's from Barmulloch, right? That was in Parkhead, far away from his home. So you can't blame it on the family. Those are fans, and the fans love him. You know? Look at Nicole Jasmine. She's killing it in community pro wrestling as well. With my cousin Stan. Jesus.
Who will eventually get online, hopefully. But no, I'm going to community pro wrestling at the end of July. That's my, because they're going to come up to Peterhead, because that's where I am, up in the northeast. So I'm Elgin. So I'm between Inverness, Aberdeen, that kind of area. So,
wait, is it the one in it's not Barmore. July 9th.
July 28th, I think it is. It's Friday.
The community show.
Yeah, community pro. It's at Peterhead Football Club.
Oh, okay, yeah, I'm not there.
Yeah. Oh well, we're just talked about it, and your name would be there, so it's fine. Hopefully, tickets are still available, etc.
If I can just give a quick shout out, who's wrestling on that show is my very good friend Lee McRae, who we trained together in GPWA, and he's fighting Ravy Davy. So yeah, I think that's the main event. Very proud of that boy, and if you're gonna go there, you're gonna enjoy that match. I can guarantee you that match is gonna be amazing.
I'm just excited to see new faces. I was hoping I would see your cousin at the show, but you know,
I know, right?
That's the way it is. It looks good. It looks just interesting. I remember speaking to Ravy Davy about it, and it was my thought when I spoke to him beforehand, when it initially came up, community pro wrestling, Peterhead Football Club. I went,
yeah.
Davy thinks he's wrestling on the pitch, isn't he? And I thought that was a wee joke to myself. And then when I interviewed him, I asked him, and he was like, oh, I thought we were wrestling on the pitch. I was like, oh, yes. I love it when that happens.
If you get a chance, right? I hope you don't mind me saying this. On the 29th of July, we are having Iron Gilder show in Parkhead. Mm-hmm. And we just announced like a massive main event. I don't know if I'm going to be on the show. I don't know. No one knows at this point. But we know that main event is going to be Levi against Mark Andrews against Eddie Castle. And I can tell you that's going to be a massive match. Like, if you're a fan, again, I know Mark Andrews from NXT UK. I'm going to watch that match. I'm going to be there. Even if I'm not booked, I'm going to be there to watch that show, you know? If you got chance, I would highly recommend the Gilder shows. They are world-class wrestling. And I'm so proud to be a member of Iron Gilders just now. That's like where I'm training just now. So we left GPWA and now like we followed BT Gunn, and all of us are in Gilders just now. Honestly, you got a chance.
That was the weird thing though, because of course when you started, it was 2019, you said January 2019 is when you started. So you had about a year-ish, over a year of a GPWA, and then of course everything shut down because of the pandemic. And of course, I mean, I say of course so many times in these interviews, but you started in January, Lionheart passed away in the June as well, so it must have been that first year. We've already mentioned all the stuff outside of wrestling that was going on, and then the inside wrestling, you were going absolutely all out because this is what you were going to do, and then stuff like that happened, then a pandemic happens. There must have been a moment when that happened, and then after all that, you moved schools from that point. You followed BT Gunn, Wolfgang to Iron Girders, and there you are now. So you've had quite a tumultuous, no, that's not a word, and I can't think of the word it actually is. See, English is supposed to be my first language. It's really somewhere. But you had a very interesting first year when it came to wrestling, and now that then you made your debut. I've got it written down as May 2022. I don't know if that's right. Was it May last year you had your actual debut match?
Yeah. It was my first match. It was Gilders, and it was a Gauntlet match. And
the big battle royal. It's on YouTube.
It's on YouTube. That's like my whole debut is on YouTube. If you want to watch, just go on the Aaron Gilders YouTube channel. You can watch all the matches over there. That debut. Just can I talk about it if it's all right?
Absolutely, you go for it.
So at this point, I was maybe training 3 years if I count COVID, right? And I meant to make my debut like before that, like many times, but always it didn't work out. Always something wrong, right? And there were so many times I wanted to give up. There were so many times I just want to screw this. I'm going back to Czech Republic and screw all of this. You know, I made it sound easy before, but it wasn't easy. This is the whole professional wrestling. It's mentally very, very hard. Mm-hmm. You know, like you put up the work, you work hard, you know, and then nothing comes in, you know. I was lucky. I have some friends who always had my back, right? They always told me to stay, you know, to work hard. My chance will come. One of those people is Krobar, who is another Slav, you know. Mm-hmm. I know that some smart ass right now typing a comment or something. Oh, he was born in Hamilton. No. Krobar is Polish. He's 100% Polish, and he's my Slavic brother. And he was the one who always supported me. Then BT Gunn always had my back, always. And I super appreciate it. He's the guy who took me in. He's my coach since the day number one. You know what I mean? he always had my back. When we were doing the COVID, when it was the COVID, he always took me in for the 1-on-1 classes in Gilders. So it was just me and him, and we were training. You know, like he always made time for me. See, it's like when you like need something of him, like so you just text him, he will reply you. You know what I mean? Like he's just amazing human being, and he's my hero. He's my role model. What can I say? And Krobar, same as Krobar, is completely the same. If BT Gunn is not there, Krobar is the guy. You know, I ask for advice. Then another person like that is Ravy Davy, who helps me with community pro wrestling. And thanks to his help, Stan became like very, very popular. You know, Stan owes him like nearly everything. There were like, and then like people like Daro, who, you know, once I was like very, very depressed, and he very, very helped me out. My fiance, my friends from Czech Republic, you know. But then, you know, when Wolfgang, another person, Wolfgang was helping me as well. Anyway, I got a message from Wolfgang. I was at work. I shouldn't be on my phone, but I was. Got a message, and he texts me, "Can you do some promo pictures for a poster?" I'm like, Is it happening? Please tell me it's happening. Come on. So I was like, yeah, I'm available this time. So I was like, I tried to be calm, you know, but inside I was like, yes. So I remember I was driving to Gilders to get my first promo pictures. I was nervous. I was very nervous. I was listening to Nirvana, you know. What was the songs I was listening to? It was like, anyway, that doesn't matter. I don't know why I mentioned it. I was just listening to Nirvana. Getting my first promo pictures, I was nervous. I was sweating. That was for the first time I was in my wrestling gear as well. So I was like kind of scared what people's going to think, you know, of me. Like, oh, look at this idiot. I also designed that wrestling gear I'm wearing. So it's like, it's my design. So like, I was scared what people's going to think. No, it was good. The pictures are bad, but I already fixed that a long time ago. And yeah, what a debut. What a debut for the first time, being in front of those people, hearing them chant, hearing them react. Boy, that was amazing. Absolutely amazing. That the Iron Gilders crowd, there's nothing like Iron Gilders crowd.
It made that 3 years just all worth it, all the homelessness and the depression moments. It was just, all went away in that crowd reaction.
Three of my close people died in those 3 years, you know what I mean? So like the depression was there, but that sounds bad. I can say they made it worth it. I didn't say that for the record. I didn't say that, but you know, it caused me some depression. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. So it just made. No, mine was even worse. I was gonna say made their sacrifice worth it, and that's not what we go for either.
For the record, we never said that.
I'm hoping people understand what we're going for here. It just like all that hardship just made the beauty of the crowd reaction all the more sweeter. I think that's probably the most best way we could put it without it sounding like we're going, folk died, cool, but you've got to do some wrestling.
oh, someone died, but he can do a clothesline in front of people. Let's go.
Exactly. That's my case. I'm hoping people over 200 episodes at this point know that fingers crossed. But yes, so Aaron Gerd has made a debut. You had a little bit of a team with Martin McAllister as well, who we've had on the show in the past. I think about when we spoke to him, his record was maybe 0-10. It's not so much better now. I think it's 0-50 now, I think, something like that. 43, sorry. My apologies, Martin. I've added seven losses to your record.
I can't count every loss of him because he's a bad friend and we should have a match, another match. I'm just explaining quickly what I mean by that is because he interrupted my promo in Iron Gears. I just brought my new suit. I just came back from Czech Republic after having a match of my life with BT Gunn in Prague, where we sold out the venue, by the way. I'm just want to brag that about it. Anyway, and he came in during my promo and he interrupted me and I slapped him and we had a big brawl. Where's the rematch? Come on.
That actually brings perfectly, because your March 2023 was amazing. When I'm looking through the notes here, I mean, there's a few things, just a few things that happened. So we'll start with the Czech Republic match then. So that was VCV wrestling with BT Gunn in Czech Republic. I don't know. I mean, I the Scottish scene is where my bread and butter is. So when it comes to this Czech scene, I know nothing. So by all accounts, what you're saying, it wasn't really a Czech scene at the time. So how did that come about? How did VCV begin? Do you know?
I mean, it was there for 10 years at this time, right? Some couple of passionate guys who just love wrestling just made this scene and just getting out with it. You know, they having shows. And every year they're doing like their WrestleMania. I just text them. I was like, hey, guys, would you be interested? Hey, I'm this guy called Jan the Slavic one. You know, I'm a wrestler in Scotland and I'm the first Czech wrestler in Scotland. You know, don't want to brag again, you know. if you guys would be interested, you know, having the Slavic one on your show. And they said, yeah, they came back like literally 2 days after. And I was like, oh, definitely, you're Czech. We want you on the show. I was like, I'm very grateful for that. You know, like, give me a chance to wrestle in front of my family, in front of my friends. And we teared the roof down. Me and Tom. Oh, sorry, BT Gunn. I don't know how. First, it meant to be like a six-man tag team match. It meant to be Scotland against Czech Republic. I meant to be heel representing Scotland. And then it's just like there was some like budgeting issues and we just end up with one-on-one, me and BT Gunn, and lots of this is gonna be emotional at this moment, right? But this is one of my most beautiful memories I ever gonna have. I will never forget what BT Gunn did for me in Prague, to have this match with me and nobody, you know, to put me over, to make me a star in front of my family. Man, that pop when I pin him, I swear to God, you've never heard a bigger pop in your life. That roof exploded and we got standing ovation. Me, a guy from nowhere, from a little town in Czech Republic, got a standing ovation. Okay, let's face it, it was 90% of BT Gunn, but just I could share this moment with him. And do you know what came next? After me and BT Gunn, we stand in the ring. The fans start chanting, "This is awesome. This is awesome." I start clapping and they all got up. It was a beautiful moment. And since then, me and BT Gunn, we fell in love with the Czech scene. And we are working on some projects. I can't tell anything. I can't say anything. But we are working on big projects in Czech Republic. I want to build a bigger bridge between Czech Republic and Scotland. I want to build, I don't want to say that the scene in Czech Republic was bad, but I want to make it better. I want to bring people like Wolfgang. I want to bring people like Mark Andrews. I want to bring people like BT Gunn, like Casey Owens to Czech Republic to train Czech wrestlers and have a prop, just like ICW did all those years back in Scotland. Because before that, I hope I'm not wrong, there was no wrestling scene over here, was it?
I mean, well, ICW was 20, when did they start? Like 2010, something like that. There was a little bit. There was like, but mostly, most of the time, if you wanted to learn to wrestle, a lot of people would have had to go down to England to FWA or wherever. I'm just talking as someone who's really got into Scottish in the last like 10, 12 years. So I don't want to like tell you this is the history because I'm probably wrong. But yeah, generally, if you had to learn to wrestle in the early 2000s, you had to go to England. So that would be where you'd go. And then there wasn't that much of a scene up here outside of your mega, your camps or I think a couple of promotions are still going about. But yeah. Anyway.
That's my goal. You know, I'm to make my own wrestling school in Czech Republic. I want to open my own Iron Gators in Prague or Pilsen or anywhere. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The good thing about Czech Republic is it won't be just limited to Czech Republic. Anyone from Germany, from Austria, from Poland, from Germany. That's German already. All these people, Slovakia. How can I forget about Slovakia? Come on, we used to be one country. Anyway. all these people can come in and learn from the best. You know, I'm not talking about myself. I literally mean like BT Gunn. Like I mentioned the names before. I really wish to build a big, massive. I want to make like a goal of every wrestler to be like, oh, I want to wrestle in Czech Republic. Yeah, I want to hear like Joe Henry or I want to hear like, I know like Mark Cardona be like, oh, there's this scene in Czech Republic. I want to go there. I'm gonna text this guy called Jan. Who the hell is this guy called Stan? Anyway. I'm going to build scene over there and hopefully it will work out.
I mean, it sounds like you've still got the passion for it. I mean, when you're talking about how you got into going to that VCV show and you just went, just messaged him going, you know, I'm a Czech wrestler. I don't know if you do some of the LKS dojo. I'm assuming you do because you do some stuff for Copenhagen Pro Wrestling.
No. I'm there every week. I'm there every week with Chrissy. Oh, looking sharp.
That's all right. He said his own name in his own podcast, I think, when I interviewed him, so it's fine. But it just sounds... It sounds like the most looking sharp thing to do, though, is just to message a promoter and go, look,
and guess who's helping me with that? Guess who's helping me with that?
But yeah, so I thought, as soon as you said that, I just messaged them. I thought, yeah, definitely looking sharp somewhere involved there. Just going, you know what? You're Czech. Just message every Czech promoter and see if you can get a booking.
That sounds like looking sharp. That exactly sounds like him.
Just a little bit left Glaswegian, but yeah, no, it's just... But he's kind of doing the same. He's building the scene in the Scandinavian countries. Yeah, so you're kind of you'll take the Eastern Bloc, he'll do Scandinavia, and then you'll kind of meet in the middle somewhere. And then someone will take France. Someone should, just take France and somewhere Scotland or at least a Scottish hybrid of wrestling will just take over Europe. I like the sound of that.
Let's do this. Come on. Like, let's take over the world. Scotland forever, you know?
Why not? It'll make my life a bit busier for trying to keep in track of all of it, but, you know, that's fine. That's worth it. So, speaking of Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, then, that seems to be a good kind of through point because we're speaking about looking sharp. Of course, they started their... You did Kirk and Tillich shows. They're doing shows over here now, and I think they're one of that triangle of shows on August 5th somewhere.
Yeah,
I think. So, of course, I think I know the answer already, but when Luke Sharp came to you and went, right, I'm putting on the show, Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, it's going to be on Danish TV, we're going to stream it somewhere. I'm assuming it didn't take you very long to go, yes, I will be on that show.
That's funny, because at that time I was only wrestling for Gilders. I already got some bookings at that time, right? But I was doing one-on-ones with Looking Sharp. And that was the connection immediately. The chemicals, you know, they start working and we became friends instantly. It was him and Buffa who was training us, right? And we just hit it on. We became friends immediately, you know? And to this day, I consider him a friend. I just went another depression phase and he was helping me out a lot. He's another guy who's like always going to have my back, and I'm always going to have his back, of course. It was amazing because it was my first debut outside of GPWA/Iron Gilders. So like for the first time, I met totally strange people. I never met like guys like Zero, who are people who are my friends, like very close friends. I consider them very close. Guys like Zero, guys like Stone Malone, guys like James Blair, which I was wrestling today at W3L. Good match. You know, like these people who are regulars to his class, we became friends immediately, you know, and it was amazing. Like, I remember I was like, language barrier, right? There was a language barrier, and he was asking me, what was it? He was asking me something, and he was asking me for if I'm available. But I understood it like differently, and I told him, like, I gave him like a totally different answer, and he just shrugged it off, right? And then he texts me like, oh, what I meant was, are you available in October? we can use you on the show. I was like, yes. But I was super nervous because I didn't know anyone. At that time, I didn't know Chris. I didn't know Looking Sharp very well. Yeah, I just met him once at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So I was, the person who I knew was Crowbar. So I was with him like all this time. But yeah, I'm very grateful because that's probably the best show I've ever done. Literally the first Copenhagen show was the best show ever done, and I was involved in a battle royale, and it was one of my best matches I ever done. I had so much fun doing it with all these amazing people, you know. It was just the chemistry. The chemistry was there immediately, and since then I went every week to his class, and I'm still regular there, and I love it. I love his classes. They are brilliant.
It's just one of those things where when you look at, when you see like training wrestlers, you see some places that are charging an extortionate amount to do training, and then you look at it, and then the thing is, you always have to look at what have they done, what have your trainers done. GPWA being a great example, you get what you pay for. You pay a certain amount and you get trained by guys who have wrestled all over the world, so you pay that premium. But Looking Sharp, who has wrestled all over the world, who's wrestled in China, who's wrestled in the US, who's wrestled in Europe, he's charging £5 a session.
Exactly,
he is. It's ridiculous. He should be charging more, but he's just wanting to at least he wanted to build a scene quickly. See, and to do that is to provide quality training at an affordable price.
The very good thing about Looking Sharp is that he knows everything, and what I mean by that is like ring chemistry, wrestling moves. He knows lucha libre. He knows strong style. He knows catch wrestling, and what he's doing is, doesn't matter how big you are, doesn't matter how small you are, doesn't matter if you're female or male or something in between, it doesn't matter. He will teach you everything. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's a good thing because you need that. Let's say I'm going to work with Rey Mysterio. Let's say Rey Mysterio, right? And he's going, do you know any lucha libre? No, I don't. I was trained only a British. I was like, see, now I can do it because I was like, oh yeah, I was like Looking Sharp and he teach me some lucha libre moves. I can show you something if you want. you know, like he teaches everything. That's a good, because let's say, let's compare Source and another amazing school that, you know, had to close recently, and let's say the School of Wrestling in Glasgow, Davies School.
All right, okay.
Let's compare those two schools, right? In Source, they will teach you everything, how to do moves, how to perfect the moves, how to make it beautiful, how to be a good wrestler. In the Davies School, they will teach you how to be entertainer, how to involve the crowd in, how to involve, you know, the fans, how to make sure they're gonna enjoy the product you're making, right?
Mm-hmm.
Looking sharp teaches both.
Yeah, and you're saying that he knows everything, but if he doesn't know something, he's got like this. I've always joked that if Luke King Sharp stood on his black book of contacts, he'd be 6 foot tall, because he knows everyone. So he'll know someone who, if you want to learn a little bit about more extreme wrestling, he knows Mikey Whipwreck. He knows you want to know something a bit more independent. He knows someone from Evolve. He knows someone from he knows Buffa. If you want to know something he knows so many people. He's made so many contacts that he's probably one of the most. I say he's probably one of the more valued members of the Scottish scene because of the people he knows, not just because of what he can do himself. Every time anyone mentions Luke Sharp on his podcast, I just spend like a couple minutes just blowing smoke up his arse. It's ridiculous at this point. And he's like amazing. 10 years younger than me, and it's disgusting.
but he's amazing. Like you said, like he's absolutely amazing. He's one of those great coaches, right? I remember I took my friend on one of his classes, JP Raj. He just made his debut last night at Iron Gators. He made his debut. Amazing match. I'm very proud of the guy. You should keep an eye on him. Anyway, he had some issues, right? He couldn't get a proper moveset. He couldn't get moves working. He had issues with getting the crowd involved. Then I took him on one class with Looking Sharp. And that changed everything. Like, literally since then, he's a different person. And I think that contributed to his debut. That he finally had his debut because he took those classes with Looking Sharp. He teaches some lucha libre that moves that he uses till this day. You know, like he helped him a lot. He can help. He can teach. He's a very, very good coach. And I can't put him over more. He's just brilliant. What can I say?
Absolutely, I'm absolutely in agreement with that, because anytime I've spoken to him and even approached him with ideas and stuff like that, I had a wee brief notion and I thought, I'm going to try commentary. I tried it once. I thought, I'm okay what I'm doing. I'll stick with that. Because I didn't realise how difficult commentary was until I tried it. I thought, I don't know how anyone could do this live. But I sent it to him and he had a wee listen to it and he had a look at it and he thought, okay, there's probably something we could do with this. But it's like, he always focuses on the strength over the it was like, right, you can do this. We're going to focus on that. We'll fix the rest of it. But if we focus on this, we can get you somewhere. That's the Looking Sharp portion of the podcast completed.
Okay, who else is there? Let's talk about BT Gunn. BT Gunn.
Well, the next person I was going to bring up was Crowbar, because we talked about Copenhagen Championship Wrestling.
Yes, please.
And so you had your debut, and then when they returned at the start of the year, well, March, I don't know if you consider that still the start of the year. It's in the first half, it counts.
It is.
This is the event that was put out on YouTube, or at least your matches segment.
Yeah, you're right.
They started with like 9 minutes of you and Crowbar speaking about Eastern relationships, and then
it was so hard to not break, because Crowbar started talking about his dad, and then I remind him of his dad and stuff like that. Looking Sharp was in the backstage crying of laughter when he heard that. I was like trying to not laugh, you know, but I was like, that was amazing. That was amazing. But yeah, the promo was quite long. I'm not gonna lie.
I know. Well, I'm quite hard of hearing anyway. So I was watching it going, I have no idea what anyone is saying here. And then the match eventually started. I was like, okay, cool. I'm in. But it was a bold choice for the for the debut streaming event, debut video, and the 10-minute video about Eastern European politics, and then go, right, there's some wrestling now as well. But yeah, so you've formed a team with Crowbar, though, the Eastern Bloc, and you were put straight in the deep end as a team. You were against Glasgow Grindhouse, remember rightly?
Yeah, I love that.
Which, you know, that must have been, for everything, outside of course, your singles match with BT Gunn would have been a bucket list check.
Yeah,
but being able to team with a fellow Slav and then go against Looking Sharp, one of your coaches, it must have been just like mind blowing.
see, we need to appreciate Crowbar a little bit more, because the guy, what he did for Scottish wrestling scene, that's amazing. Just look at his accomplishments, right? ICW tag team champion, the guys he was wrestling with, I'm horrible with names. The two Americans, what's their name? Them boys down AEW.
Oh, the
Briscoes. He wrestled with in Hydro. You know, they wrestled with them in Hydro. He just the big names he wrestled with. And the guy, we were talking about how Looking Sharp is smart about wrestling. What about Crowbar? Crowbar is one of the most legit wrestlers I know. The guy, if he also, he can kill you. he will kill you if you cross him. He will kill you in that ring. Never shoot on Crowbar. That's my advice. But no, the guy is absolutely brilliant. He understands everything. You can't imagine how much he was a big help to Stan during his debut. Stan's match against Crowbar at was it CPW Barmalok? Was it Barmalok?
I think it was. Haven't got it written down. I'll take your word for it.
Let's say it was Barmalok. One of his favorite matches, definitely. Here, the stuff he learned from him during that one match is more than I learned during the 3 years in GPWA. Again, I'm not trying to throw any shade on GPWA. Absolutely not. I'm not doing it. I love GPWA. Even though I'm not trained there, I still love the company. The school, I still love them. So I don't want anyone to think I like throwing shades at GPWA. What I'm trying to say is Crowbar is super smart. And I was scared. I was scared wrestling with him, you know? Again, I'm still... This is March. This is March last year. I'm still very inexperienced. It was before Prague, right? And before that, I had two very bad matches. So I was very nervous. But no, stuff I learned from him, I will carry with me till the day I'm going to die. The stuff he showed me, the stuff he told me, he knows how good of a heel he is as well. He makes entrance and he makes the people hate him. And that makes for me or for Stan, when he makes his entrance easier because people immediately love Stan because Crowbar's in the ring and he's being a massive dick, you know? Guy is absolutely incredible. Honestly, like, if you got a chance to watch him live, watch him live. Him and Stevie James as well, The Perch. That's one of the best tag teams in Scotland in history. Might be even the best tag team in history in Scotland. And I don't... is there any better tag team? Tell me a better tag team. Better than Glasgow Grindhouse. Sorry, Looking Sharp, but Crowbar is way... The Perch, come on.
I mean, for me, I'm a Northeast boy, so I'll always throw in Foundation Future guys because I love them. But you know,
I saw them on the same show, so they were absolutely brilliant. Mm-hmm. The Foundation Future, I was with them in Helensburgh, and they were in the main event. Absolutely amazing guys, fucking.
But I like that it's all relative though, because people like what they like. So you like the style of the Purge. Some people will go, oh no, I don't like them. I like this team. Who cares? As long as you like it, I don't know. Like, always like Wilson. I honestly, it's like this divide on the internet, especially on Twitter. Is like if you like one thing, you can't like the other. It's like no, you can like both. Just like it. Just enjoy it. Just pay your money. Yeah, absolutely. So that's Crowbar section done. So I'm going to go through some of the questions we got through. So you got some anonymously through NGL, which I deleted the app recently because the questions just got weirder and weirder as the days went on.
I know, right? I know. There were lots of horny questions. I'm like, what the hell is wrong with them?
People feel very safe when it's anonymous, and I don't like it.
I just like it because like I think people are more relaxed to ask questions because you don't see who asked them, and I love using them. But anyway, sorry.
No, but I mean, I like using it when like I run a website. I mean, it's all off my own back. I don't get paid. I get a little bit, but it's the questions that come and go. Oh, who's the worst wrestler? Who's the worst interviewer? Like, how does that benefit me answering that kind of thing? So, this guy was the absolute worst. He was, Stan hasn't turned up. But probably is marked down as one of the worst ones. But it's like, I can't go, oh, this guy was absolutely dire. Because what if I go see a show with them in the future and I've just sat and rinsed them on Instagram?
Yeah.
And that's just, it just I mean, I think the only person I've proper rinsed in anything was probably Omar Mohammed. I saw his first match. It was on, still on YouTube, ridiculously. I shouldn't be. And I absolutely ripped him apart. And I now consider him kind of a friend, honestly. It's weird how things work out. But yeah. No, it's the folk just, looking for negativity. It's like, no. I love wrestling. I want to speak about how amazing it is, and that's exactly what we're doing. That's what we're doing this for.
It's like the AEW and WWE war.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to talk about negatives. I want to talk about positives. Hey,
that's it.
You know, like, that's... WWE is doing a great job with Roman Reigns, the Bloodline, one of the best stories in years. But hey, AEW's got MJF, who's a massive heat magnet, and Forbidden Door, which is today of recording. I mean, it's gotta be an amazing show. You know, I mean, what I'm trying to say is like. Focus on the positives.
That's it. I mean, I don't watch AEW, so I can't really go on. I can't go on the internet. How old did I sound there? I can't go. I can't go on Twitter and just go. I don't like AEW.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't watch it. What I've seen, I haven't been a fan of, so I haven't continued watching it. That's it. Bam. Don't need to. I don't hate it. I just don't watch it.
It's like I don't watch AEW either, right? Maybe I see some clips online, but the thing is, like the online community, like on Facebook or like these groups, like, oh, this was very cringy. Ooh, look, they didn't sell enough tickets. You're supposed to help that company. Like, how does it benefit? Sorry if I'm saying it this way. Shitting on the other company. Isn't it better if both companies are successful? This way, there is more work for us, and there's more entertainment. For the wrestlers, you know what I mean? For the fans.
Yeah. At the end of the day, it's just a bunch of people in pants fighting over a belt. So, you know, it's just, you got to kind of, you got to take it in context. I mean, here we are, you're in your 20s, I'm in my 30s, and we're both speaking about wrestling. And to be honest, both of our parents are respectively thought we'd grow out of it by now. So, we've just got to. At least it isn't drugs, you know. I said it.
Just get the sticks and and some bleeding in the ring. At least it's not drugs.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you can stick that. If I believe that I'm doing podcasts, something's gone very wrong somewhere down the line. But anyway, so NGL, the terrible website for anonymous questions. So we haven't got any of the horny questions, thankfully. I mean, I don't know if you wanted to share any of them, but I don't know if that's what you want to leave that between you and your fiance about. So, well, the ones I have here, so we've got a nice simple one. What's your favorite sport? I don't know whether you consider wrestling a sport, if it's a sports entertainment, or how you kind of classify it, but favorite sport.
I mean, favorite sport, right? If I don't count wrestling, I'm from Czech Republic. I'm Czech. So, 100% is ice hockey. Ice hockey is massive in Czech Republic, right? One of the best ice hockey players in the world are from Czech Republic. One of the best ice hockey players in the world is from Czech Republic. Jaromír Jágr, come on. The guys are smashing it, you know. I actually was thinking I would have like an ice hockey gimmick one day, you know. I can't skate, I can't play it, I just love watching it. It's like a big thing, you know, like every year there's a world championship. It's like a WrestleMania for every Czech. And we always, Czech and Slovakians, and we always watch it every year. There's a great support, you know. We Slavic people, we love ice hockey. Canada and America, they love it as well, but not like us. It's like very serious.
So were you speaking about the gimmick, doing a bit of an ice hockey gimmick? So have you seen The Goon?
Yeah, The Goons. Yeah.
Something like that then. Yeah.
Exactly.
Anyway, you're saying.
I'm going to try answer these questions like very, very quickly. I don't want to try like rambling, like so I don't have to explain the rules of ice hockey or something like that.
That's all right. I've got an interesting question in the second one down, which I think I've got a point in contention with it. It says, Jan, will you ever make your CPW debut? Now, correct me if I'm wrong here. You did make your CPW debut very briefly.
Did I?
Didn't you arrive at a show and get attacked? And then suddenly Stan had arrived as well. Am I remembering that right?
I don't remember that. When was this?
Someone's feeding me false information now in the results that I got. I think someone said that Jan came out, got attacked by BT Gunn, and then Stan appeared to take his place.
No. Well, that was Stan's debut. Stan made his debut, and Leon Graves attacked me. Not me. Attacked Stan.
Right.
Not me. Yeah, not the same person. Yeah, two different people. Anyway,
so I blame my source then. My source said it was yourself, and of course I'm not there. So
it was Spider-Bam who saved me. Who saved Stan? there's a source. I got bad sources as well. then it was like Spider-Bam who saved me, and then he had a match with BT Gunn.
Right. Okay. That's it. Well, I mean, if you're watching it back, sometimes you'd see yourself in Stan. That's just how it works, and it can.
I mean, we are very similar looking, so sometimes it get, you know, and I got bad memory, so sometimes I think that's me.
I mean, once the hat comes off, I mean, you could be anyone.
I know, right?
What's your favorite movie?
Oh, I'm a massive Star Wars guy. Like, I grew up on Star Wars. I really love Empire Strikes Back. Empire Strikes Back. But I grew up on prequels, so like for me it's like I know. For me it's like Revenge of the Sith, Attack of the Clones, The Phantom Menace, and The Clone Wars, especially The Clone Wars. I love Clone Wars. I don't mean the movie, I mean the TV series. Yeah, I'm a massive Star Wars guy, but that's another thing why I think I'm getting myself over, because I'm a massive movie geek, and I'm talking massive movie geek, right? And it's not like I don't watch a scene and be like, oh, that was a good scene. I always study the scene. I'm like, oh, why did this scene work, right? Why a scene with Luke Skywalker in New Hope, leaving his house and watching the sunset, why is it such a powerful scene? I will tell you why. It's the little small details that makes the scene one of the best scenes in movie history, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So,
oh, yeah. It's the two moons. It's the John Williams score. It's just kind of...
It's the way how Mark Hamill leaves the house, he kicks the rock, you know, like, oh, I hate this place, kicks the rock, you know, and then he looks at the sunset, and that's my camera, I just fell off, sorry.
the force is strong.
See, I'm Mark Hamill, who knows? Anyway, I'm the first Slavic Jedi. Anyway, so, you know, the way he kicks the rock, you know, and then he looks at the sunset and he looks with all hope, you know, and the music starts building up, and then the music goes down and he like abandons that hope and be like, oh no, I'm stuck in this plan, and he goes back. That's what makes that scene powerful, and that's what I'm trying to put into my matches. That's what Stan tries to put into his matches. These small details, you know, you might see it if you're gonna see me, I always do like these little things that makes it different, you know. But yeah, I would definitely say Star Wars. But another movies I love is, I'm a big fan of Christopher Nolan and his movies. So it's like Dark Knight, it's the Inception, it's the Interstellar, it's the, you know, like these Hollywood movies. I'm a movie geek, what can I say?
Fair enough. So we've also got, what music do you listen to? You've already mentioned Nirvana, and you're a metal guy.
Well, that's the thing. I love music that has passion, you know? Mm-hmm. I can't listen to Lewis Capaldi, right? Because it's all the same. Oh, I fell in love with this girl. Now I'm standing in the rain in Glasgow. You know, like, I love songs where people having fun. I'm a metalhead, so my favorite band of all time is Slipknot. I love Slipknot. That's what me and BT Gunn always talk about, is Slipknot. You know, we both love the band. But it's like other bands like System of the Down. I love Korn. But also, I love some rap. You know, I like Eminem. I like to listen to NWA. I like to listen to Ice Cube. I love Slavic music. I love to listen to Slavic hard bass. You know, like Stan's theme song. I love that song. The Slav King. Have you heard it?
I haven't. No.
That's a banger. It's like these like stereotypical Slavic hard bass. You know, like rave and stuff like that. Again, I'm just geek about these things. You know, again, I try to figure out why I love this song and put it in the small pieces, you know, why I think this song is brilliant. I hate pop and I hate country because I hate America. I shouldn't have said that. I don't know why I said that.
That's fine. It's fine. You can let go of reveal your prejudice here. So we've got the question is spill some tea. Now,
spill some tea.
I mean, I don't know if that's if I say we like to focus on the positives here, so I don't know if there's...
I can spill some tea. I can spill some tea right now. I don't wear any pants right now.
There we go. So for for the last, I don't know, I usually I have a clock and I check what time, how long we've been recording for, and I haven't got one because I'm in my kitchen. So for anyone who's been on for, I don't know, an hour, I'm guessing.
Hour and a half. It's a wrong podcast.
Oh, God, is it? How is my phone still on? It must be like on fire. Yeah, so for the last 90 minutes, Jan has been sitting there and he's with no pants on. So, like,
let me explain why, right? I just came from a show. I made my 3WL debut, right? And we were wrestling outside and it was raining, right? So when I came home, my clothes were soaking wet. So, and then you start the interview. I was like, okay, no, I'm just going to sit here and I'm just going to continue. So there you go. That's your tea.
That's fine. I mean, if I'm in shorts, thankfully. So, I mean, if I was also in my pants, that'd be weird.
Wait. Language barrier. Trousers. I meant to say trousers, not pants. Trousers.
Oh, right. Okay. So there is coverage down there. You're not just free balling.
Yeah. Oh, all right. Definitely. I'm not naked up the down there. If I would be, you would notice.
would the voice be like an octave higher?
Yeah, exactly.
Pressed against the leather, just this is taking a weird turn. Right, no,
we've got. And people complaining about those first questions we are getting on LG.
I know. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, this is worse than NGL. We've got a couple through Instagram. We've got Oliver Prince with just a simple phrase. Stan is the best.
Stan.
It would have been better if he was here. It would have made more sense to ask him. But, you know, again, I keep seeing it connecting every so often and disconnecting, so I have no idea what he's doing.
I'm just going to quickly shout out to Oliver Prince because he's a massive help, both me and Stan. He's like one of the biggest supporters. And he is the reason why Stan is over. It's Ollie. 100% it's Ollie. Oliver Prince, you're the man.
And we've got, last time I've got through Instagram, and then we'll ask I don't know if you'll stay in these podcasts in the past, we ask a couple stupid questions before we kind of start wrapping up. From, I think it's your other half that's asked this, Domi Heidi on Instagram. I'm going to tweak it slightly because just for purposes of, you know, wrestling. How did Stan get involved? So how did you end up getting Stan involved in wrestling?
Well, okay, let's say Davey, right? He wanted a wrestler for a show. And he had to choose between me and Stan. And I told him, I'm not going to work on your show. Me as the Slavic one, I'm not going to get over. People will not give a damn. I'm just going to be another wrestler on your show. But Stan, that's a different story. Stan, he fits more to community pro wrestling because... Okay, Nets are a big thing in Glasgow, right?
Mm-hmm.
From where the Net culture is coming from? From the Slavic people, the Slavs, the wearing Adidas, listening to hard bass, you know, drinking vodka. That's where the Net culture comes from. So I was like, Stan can bring that back and give it to the people. And it was a good decision. I know I'm moaning how I didn't get booked for CPW, but I would never get over in over there. Mm-hmm. I would never get over. That's why Stan comes in. And Stan is, by Davey's words, top 5 most over guys in CPW.
Mm-hmm.
Because fits well, you know. It's that whole Slavic culture that people love from the internet, you know, like the squats, you know, the cheeky bricky, you know, drinking vodka, listening to hard bass. People love that, and I'm very happy for Stan that he got so much over in CPW.
So hopefully he gets enough payday so he can get a decent internet connection. So the last two questions,
he was spending it on the vodka anyway, so like
I know. He'll be looking at the EU, and or do you think is it just a Smirnoff bottom of the shelf cheap ass? Or
we got better vodka than Smirnoff.
To be perfectly honest, I'm a Grey Goose guy, but I can only have it like twice a year because it's so bloody expensive. So I have to go EU if I'm gonna just have absolute. You know, I like a flavor to my vodka.
You know what? Absolute isn't that bad. unless mm-hmm. unless you flavor the vodka with like Coke, you know, like put Coke and vodka, or mix it with like juice or something like that. Mm-hmm. Go to hell. If you mix vodka with something,
yeah. I'm sorry.
I don't know if you were CPW. It's the Russian girl Billy. Katya.
I'm Billy.
Katya. She made her debut, and we were like literally talking about how we never mix vodka with anything, and we're like, what? You drink pure vodka? Yes, we drink pure vodka. That's how we meant to be drinking. Anyway, that's good.
Oh no! If I drink pure vodka, I'm dead. So I have to water it down. I'm not a big drinker, but yeah, a little bit of a vodka and Coke, I'm all good. right. So our questions that we ask everyone, which is the stupidest ones in the world. What's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh, okay. Wait.
Oh yeah, okay. It's a wrestling podcast. But what?
Let me think. I know why you're asking. I'll listen to some episodes of your. Wait. Let me think. Don't go anywhere. Okay, because I used to be a massive dinosaur geek, and Dominica, my fiance, she is a massive dinosaur geek as well. It's not dinosaurs. No.
Like I say, it could be anything. We've had answers, like we've had turkey dinosaurs answered in the past, which was an incredible answer. We've had Pokemon mentioned. We've had Barney mentioned somewhere down the line. We've had everything. It doesn't really have to be dinosaurs per se. It could be adjacent dinosaurs. Almost just, if as long as it's kind of dinosaur themed, I'm in.
I mean, see, like. When I was watching Jurassic Park, when I was little, I always loved raptors, you know. But mm-hmm. then I realized that in real life they were like very tiny.
Mm-hmm.
So like, I would say Utah raptor, which is like the inspiration for the raptors from the movie, which is like big raptors, mm-hmm. but they have like feathers and it was very cool.
Cool. I'll go with that.
That's my answer.
And the question, which I think if you've known Tiger and Looking Sharp for any length of time, this question has probably popped up in your life before. But what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
Okay.
I love this question because either people get too into it or they're so confused by the actual concept of the question that they just go, this is a wrestling podcast. What have you done?
How can a sheep fight back?
Beauty of the question.
it's a cow. I mean, come on, look at the cows. They can be scary. I'm not joking. I once fell in a field of cows and I was scared of my life. And I was wearing Adidas tracksuit, red Adidas tracksuit. Come on, cows are scary. They can be scary. Have you seen that movie? What was the name? It was like a parody of like a kung fu movie, and there was like this cow. It was like a parody, Matrix parody, and she starts shooting milk from her, you know, and. It was like this guy was like dodging them, you know. I forgot the movie, Kung Pao or something like that.
I have never heard of it, but I
might. I will send you the link. I will send you. You need to see this. I will send you the link. It's brilliant.
And I will send you the link to a sheep beating a cow, because it's.
Wait, that exists.
Yeah.
Is it some person called Sheep?
No. It's legit. It's a cow. A cow runs towards this. No, I can't remember the order, but one of them runs towards the other. And they headbutt each other, and the cow falls over.
I don't believe that.
Oh, I will find the link. I'm responsible for probably quite a few thousand views on this particular video, so I will send it to you. But no, I think we're kind of, like you said, we've been over an hour and a half, and
I'm sorry about that.
That's all right. We've had a great chat. It's always worse if it was like, how long have we chatted for? 40 minutes. Oh, yeah. God.
I know, I used to do interviews as well. I know exactly what you mean. Like, oh my God, it's half an hour. I don't have any questions. Oh, my God.
We've covered a hell of a lot of ground. We've covered so much ground. Yeah. And unfortunately, like I say, Stan has not been able to arrive, but we've got to speak to yourself, and it's been absolutely worth it for the period that we've been on. You mentioned you made WCL debut recently. Have you got anywhere else coming up that you want to plug? I know you're not in Peterhead, so, and you've got Aaron Gerders coming up, but where else have you got, or is there anywhere you want to be as well when it comes to making your debuts? And
the thing is, right, I'm very bad with memories. So I was booked for a Davey show and I didn't even know I'm on it. Like, literally on that day, I'll find out, like, oh my God. Oh, you're right. Oh my God. You know, what's my next show? God damn it. We just announced that I'm going to fighting a big strong man in July in Community Pro Wrestling.
Yeah, it just went up today, wasn't it?
Just before you sent me the link, it was announced. Yeah. That's why my phone was buzzing for a second and the camera was falling off because people were texting me about that match. then August, Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, Eastern Bloc, baby, is coming back. I'm fighting James Blair again. Excited for the match. Crowbar's fighting Big Mick. If you haven't seen Crowbar live, you need to watch him. He's brilliant. It's like watching sheep kicking cow's ass.
I love it.
And also, I need to plug Iron Gators because that's where I'm from. You know, that's like my number one. That everything starts from Iron Gators. 29th of July, massive show. Mark Andrews in the main event. Come and see us. Come and see us. I might be there. Come say hi to Jan. I might tell you to fuck off, but at least you said hi because I'm a bad person.
Love it. So for the future, I mean, I'm assuming ICW is probably your top of your list. That's where you want to. That would be your pinnacle.
The future, the future, like my future plans, the shows I would love to work for. Target is one of my targets. No pun intended. I don't know if I can say it. I'm quite in talks with them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we send two messages to each other. Target, I would love to wrestle for Target. Another company, ICW, I would love to be in ICW, but I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon. But I would love to be involved with ICW. And I would love to do more international shows. There is this show in Finland called Slam. This famous Finnish wrestler of Starbuck, he runs it. And okay. I have a friend over there from Slovakia. She's a referee. I would love to work for him as well. I'd try my best, send him CVs. He knows about me. I think he does. Because he heard about my match with BT Gunn in Prague. I would love to wrestle in Prague again. Definitely. And I know this is gonna be crazy, but I would love to work for WWE. I'm not saying it's gonna happen. I'm saying I would love to be the first ever Czech wrestler in WWE. That's my goal, you know?
Not impossible. I mean, they've already had Polish wrestlers. They've got half of the main Scottish scene from the early 10s. So, I mean, it's not impossible. And it seems like you've got the right path and the people behind you to do it. It's nothing that's impossible. Well, this has been an absolutely amazing chat. I'm so glad that we've been able to get this in and eventually. And like I said, I'm hoping when this goes up that it looks okay, because for me, you're in the big screen and I'm like in the corner, so I don't know how it's gonna look when I download it later. If it's just you and just me, the sound of me, then this could be the most it'll just be all yarn, all the time.
I can tell you what you're gonna see. You're gonna see me swinging the camera, being all angry because it's falling off all this time. When we start the show, literally when you start recording, my phone starts buzzing and my coins start falling from next to my microphone. So I'm like, oh my God, how did I could literally the moment you start the show, you. So that's what you heard at the beginning. I really apologize for that.
That's right. So this could be the most chaotic episode for editing anyway, but I'll deal with that tomorrow. But
also, no, I want to apologize for the time as well. Like, we meant to do it earlier. I was just make my W3L debut and then it came back from five. Very apologize for that.
That's right.
Hopefully it's for you.
No, absolutely. Like I say to anyone, if you get a paid gig, take it. We'll sort out my stuff in our time. Anyway, we're going to stop the recording and we can have a wee chat afterwards if you want. Or if not, you can just dump me afterwards.
Yeah, but, I'm just going to be mean. I'm just gonna be mean now. They're like, oh, okay. Oh, what a stupid question you ask. Oh my god. I'm gonna shit on your podcast.
That sheep and cow for a stupid question. Oh,
what how did you ask about sheep and cow? Who gives a damn about dinosaurs?
Ask Lou about the sheep and dinosaur, because sheep and cow.
who would win a fight, sheep or dinosaur?
I mean, what kind of dinosaur? This is the open-endedness of the question. It's like, if a sheep may be able to beat like a really tiny dinosaur, like a lizard, but if it's like a T-Rex, it doesn't stand a chance. So it's that's the variable here.
I never know. Makes the question interesting. T-Rex has small brains, so
you can outsmart them. I think a sheep would have to be very smart to kind of get past anything by a dinosaur, but you know, I don't know. Who knows? One day we'll find out. Google it.
I can see like a sheep like dressed as a female T-Rex, be like, "Yoo-hoo, I'm here," and then just fell in a trap with like a spice or something. We're like, "How? I'll beat you! Hey, who is the alpha male now? Eh? I'm the sheep from Eastern Bloc."
And with that, thank you very much for joining me on the SWN podcast. Have a good one.
Thank you. Thank you for involving. And thank you for having me here.
Pigeon, I need to write a message to Jan. I need pigeon. Does anyone have a pigeon?
Stan, use a phone, you idiot.
Jan? Oh, Jan! Yeah. I didn't forget. Yeah. Interview. Yeah. Podcast. Scottish Wrestling Podcast. Yeah. I will be there. I promise, okay? If anything, I will send you a pigeon. Why are you so angry all of a sudden? Come on. Okay, I will be there. I promise. All right, bye.
This thing works. Jesus. Well, look here, isn't it? Little Stanislav. I don't even think you're a real Stan. I don't know how I'm touching you right now. You're just a little boy. Bet you're not even a real Slav. I bet I could outdrink you.
Whoa. I'll drink.
Drink.
You mean drink. Drinking goddess.
Easy.
Vodka. Easy.
What?
You're on.
All right, boys. Shot number one. Go. Shot number two. Shot number 69.
You're not human. You're not human.
No. No. I'm the Slav King.
Whoa!
Damn.
I hope you like for the podcast. I'll go find you one.